السلام على المبعوث رحمة العالمين نبينا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد اليوم 6 من شهر رجب 1442 الموافق ل 18 من شهر فبراير 2021 نواصل درسنا في هذا الكتاب المبارك الداء والدواء and last time we stopped at the scene of the مؤلف فصل المعاصي سبب للفساد this is a new chapter that we discuss about the ma'asi being one of the consequence one of the asbab the causes of the fasad corruption on earth almost in everything not just on people but on plants on the land itself almost everything so يقول المؤلف رحمه الله ومن آثار الذنوب والمعاصي أنها تحدث في الأرض أنواع من الفساد في المياه والهواء والزروع والثمار والمساكن قال تعالى ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس ليذيقهم بعض الذي عملوا لعلهم يرجعون Ibn Al Qayyim says ومن آثار الذنوب والمعاصي أنها تحدث في الأرض أنواع من الفساد في المياه والهواء He said, one of the evil consequences of dhunub, the ma'asi, أنها تحدث في الأرض أنواع من الفساد. It causes a lot of different types of corruptions on earth. It causes different types of corruption on earth. في المياه, in the water people are using to drink. والهواء, in the air. والزروع, in the plantations. والثمار, and in the fruits also. والمساكن and in the houses. So what else left? Almost it causes corruption in everything. Subhanallah. You know, if people understand this, bismillah ta'ala, if they understand and they agree, you know, they will do participate in trying to restrict themselves from these ma'asi. لعل الله سبحانه وتعالى يبعد عنا بعض شؤمها. قال الله تعالى ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس ليذيقهم بعض الذي عملوا لعلهم يرجعون Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says corruption is rampant you know it's dominating places you know wherever you go you see it في البر والبحر you see it on the land and you see it also in the sea you know في البر والبحر Corruption exists, facade exists, and it is dominating places, not just the place where the people are living. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it is also there in the sea. بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ And this corruption is taking place due to that which people are doing. So subhanAllah, it is the result of the attitude and the manners of people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ So that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let them taste that which, I mean, some part of that which they are doing. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ Maybe they will reflect and come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance. So, I want you to pay attention to this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says corruption is everywhere. On the earth, in the sea also. So, what do you have? We have two places, either the land or the sea. So corruption is there on the land, and corruption is there also in the sea. And why do we have this corruption? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ Because of the attitude of the people, what their hand earned. وَلِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا And Allah is doing that so that He will test them, the evil consequence of, some of the evil consequence of that which they did. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ The purpose of this kind of test, you know, and a reduction that they have and also decrease they have in the barakah and also the facade and every kind of any corruption that is taking place in their territories, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing that so that people will reflect and come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance. قال مجاهد إذا ولي الظالم سعى بالظلم والفساد فيحبس الله بذلك القطرة. Mujahid bin Jabr says, if unfortunately a leader is oppressing the people, you know, an oppressor becomes a leader of a people. If you have an oppressor who is appointed to lead a people, Al-Mujahid says, فيحبس الله القطرة. Because of this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to block people from getting the qatr. Al-qatr huwa al-matar, rain. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blocked them from getting the rain. فَيَهْلِكُ الْحَرْثَ وَالنَّسْلِ. And because of this, since there is no rain, who is going to get into trouble? Al-harth, you know, that's the plantation. And also al-nasl and the progeny. So everyone is going to get affected, you know. The progeny, you know, human life is going to be affected, you know, significantly. Why is that? Because you have one of the leaders is oppressing people. And because of that, people are going to be affected. Somebody might say, why, you know, people are not the one who are doing this, and he's the oppressor, but why does it affect others? But don't forget, usually having a zalim leading a people, that's a signal and a sign that the attitude and the manners of the people are not in a good shape. If we fix our attitude and manners, we will not get this person to be leading us. But we also have problem in our life, in our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let him get ability to lead us. كَمَا يَقُولُونَ يعني كَمَا قَالَ الْعُلَمَاءَ كَمَا تَكُونُوا يُوَلَّ عَلَيْكُمْ. Your leaders are the reflection of your attitudes and your manners. That's where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُصِيبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاصَّةً. When the fitna comes, usually it doesn't affect those who are involved in it. Those who brought it, it will affect also others who are not involved in it. Abdurrahman, Sauti Wadeh. So the sound is not clear. Okay, then I think I have to change the location. I'm doing some recording in the place, so I don't want to change the shape of the camera. I said today, let me have a class in that area of the house, but unfortunately the connection is not in my favor. So give me a few seconds. Let me move to the normal place, inshallah. Barakallahu feekum. السلام على المبعوث رحمة العالمين نبينا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد اليوم 6 من شهر رجب 1442 الموافق ل 18 من شهر فبراير 2021. بإذن الله تعالى, we continue with our درس in this book of الداء والدواء. And last time we stopped at the saying of the مؤلف, فصل ومن آثار المعاصي أو الذنوب أنها تحدث في الأرض أنواعا من الفساد في المياه والهواء والزروع والثمار والمساكن. قال تعالى, ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس ليذيقهم بعض الذي عملوا لعلهم يرجعون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس ليذيقهم بعض الذي عملوا لعلهم يرجعون. Is it recording? Okay. So Ibn Al Qayyim says, ومن آثار الذنوب والمعاصي أنها تحدث في الأرض أنواعا من الفساد في المياه والهواء. One of the evil consequences of المعاصي, أنها تحدث في الأرض أنواع من الفساد في المياه والهواء. It causes variety types of corruption في الأرض on the earth, في المياه in the water, والهواء in the air, والزروع in the plant, والثمار in the fruit also. So what else? والمساكن, you know, and the houses and the buildings. So what else is left? You know, it causes a problem in everything. And as I said, I wish everyone understand this fact, because only when we understand it correctly, then we will be able, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, to participate in bringing good to the community, especially the Muslim communities. قال تعالى ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس ليذيقهم بعض الذي عملوا لعلهم يرجعون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says corruption is rampant. You can find it everywhere, in the sea, and also in the land. You know, you find it on the land, you find it in the sea. Allah says bima kasabat aydin nas, and this is taking place due to that which the hands of the people earned. So the corruption that is taking place in our community, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is letting it to happen. Why? Because of our attitude. That's why he says bima kasabat aydin nas. What is the purpose of that? He says لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can hold us accountable, hold us accountable of some part of what we are doing, in order to force us to reflect and to come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance. So the purpose of these tests is to cause the person to reflect and come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says وَمَا أَصَابَكُم مِّن مُصِيبَةٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَصَابَكُم مِّن مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَيَعْفُوا عَنْ كَثِيرٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whatever happened to you of musiba and calamity, it is taking place due to that which your hand earned. وَيَعْفُوا عَنْ كَثِيرٍ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving and overlooking the vast majority of our bad manners. Which means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not holding us accountable of everything we're doing, subhanallah. Because if he is to do that, for sure, nobody will remain on earth. You know? That's why he says, وَلَوْ يُؤَخِذُ اللَّهُ النَّاسَ بِمَا كَسَبُوا مَا تَرَكَ عَلَىٰ ظَهْرِهَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to treat people and hold them responsible of every single thing they're doing, مَا تَرَكَ عَلَىٰ ظَهْرِهَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ, there will not be on earth, you know, a single animal, you know, or human beings, or jinns, or insects, or birds, or fish, you know, nothing will remain on earth. Subhanallah. And in two places Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and as this so that we can reflect upon his blessings and his ni'mah, he wallah. There are a lot. وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. So Allah says, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجُونَ. وَقَالَ مُجَاهِدْ إِذَا وَلِيَ الظَّالِمُ سَعَى بِالظُّلْمِ وَالْفَسَادِ فَيَحْبِسُ اللَّهُ بِذَلِكَ الْقَطْرَ فَيَهْلِكُ الْحَرْثُ فَيَهْلِكُ الْحَرْثُ وَالنَّسْلُ. وَاللَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْفَسَادِ. Mujahid says, if a zalim, an oppressor, is appointed to lead a people, he says, and he does the oppression, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to let the corruption take place, you know, as a result of his oppression. And what will happen after that? We will lose the harth, which is the plantation, the crops and the fruits, we will lose them. And also we will lose the nasl, and the progeny, you know, the animals will be gone, and life is going to be taken, you know, in all of its forms. Wallahu la yuhibbu al-fasad, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't like corruption. So as I was saying earlier, somebody might say, but we don't do the oppression, he was the one who was doing. But don't forget, these leaders who are oppressors, they have, you know, chance to lead us because of our attitude. كَمَا تَكُونُ يُوَلَّا عَلَيْكُمْ. They are the reflection of who we are. You know, this is not justification of their oppression. You know, they are also on a trial, and they will be in trouble because of their oppression. Regardless of the attitude of the community, they are not supposed to oppress anyone. Allah hates oppression, and He will never tolerate it. But at the same time, coming back to us, we also participated in that corruption, because we brought the leaders, especially in the new and the current system that we are following everywhere, whereby people have to go for the election. And based on the majority, we choose. And you know what will happen if this system is being followed. In every, almost every place, these are the system, except if the country is following the monarchy system. Or else we go with the common one, which is shaky, you know. And the US, they realize, as they told us, they realize that if they don't modify the system, America, you know, the US will end up being led by somebody who is wrong, you know, a wrong person. They have been getting this from time to time, even with that system, because they don't apply it correctly. But this is an indicator that the system we're following is shaky. The producers of the system also denied, they modified a bit to protect their interests. For us, the Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us a very excellent system. As long as the community is intact, you know, and people are doing the thing in the way it should be done, you know, we shouldn't face any problem because we have people who are concerned. They're concerned of nothing except how to develop the country and the city and how to provide peace, you know, and tranquility into the life of every single citizen. They don't care about themselves. But unfortunately, nowadays, in almost every country, I have to pay a lot of money for me to get to the sultan. What do you think will happen if I have to pay a lot of money? You know, in the real circumstances, people will be running away from it. You know, people will be running away from it. You have the Ahlul Hal wal Aqd, they will sit down, you know, to decide who should lead the Ummah. And this Ahlul Hal wal Aqd, they are the authority and the scholars and the leaders of the community. These three entities, they will sit down, you know. And they have, you might find some of the legal advisors, the good ones, you know, to come and join the meeting. They have to sit down and shortlist, you know, and bring a couple of people, you know, list of them, who can possibly lead. And then they do the election, they themselves, in that room, you know. They choose for the Ummah the best. The one who chose did not look for it, he doesn't even know about it. That's why sometimes you might give him and he say, I don't want, run away from it. Because it is responsibility. And if a person knows how much he is responsible in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will definitely stay away from it. And Umar used to say that, if a camel, you know, stumble, you know, himar or camel stumble in Iraq, I will be afraid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala questioning me about that. We're talking about himar. And now how many people not even stumbling, you know? How many people are dying because of the oppression of the oppressors, you know? People are suffering so much in many places, you know, so that you can understand that the responsibility of the authority is very big. Are you done with your work? Switzerland, okay. Please give me one second.
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu
alaikum.
Wallahi. في محاضرة لا تقبل الناس ولا تسلم
بس رأيتك هنا يعني تمسك التليفون وتفتي يعني خلاص الحمد لله إن شاء الله بخير يعني والله اشتقت لك
كيف الصحة والأهل
والله الحمد لله كل شيء بخير
قلنا يوما أنت متفرق حتى نخرج ونجلس مكان في الدنيا ولا تحدث بدون لمس ولا الشم ولا اي شيء
والله طيب خلي ان شاء الله
تعال البوي سنة كثير خلينا نخرج يوم النجس
والله انا لا كنت الله يشهد اشتقيت لك عن الاسبوع الماضي كنت بدأت اتصل بك فجيت رايتك واقف هنا تدور وتمسك التليفون خلاص بخير ان شاء الله في وقت سألت عليك الدكتور سعد قال والله شيخ إبراهيم لا نراه أصبح مثلك يعني
لا صلي معهم قطعت شوية لما كان الإذاعة في المسجد أنا مرت في المسجد في البيت قلت أصلي مع الله
هاي بخصوصية ما كانوا عاملينها أصلا
والله مستعان
قالت هي لا هو إنه يعطلني صار
MCO.
بس في مشكلة ما أعرف هم وجدوها اللي هي ال.
نعم.
عندها مستر اوريدي لان هي خرجت في مارش حسب ما 8 مارش فقالت ويل سي عملت ذهبت بحثت قالت يجب ان تكون مع بعض يعني انا اعرف قلت ربما تغير الرجال قلت لا احنا خلاص طالب يعني
هم اتصلوا
انا اتصل بهم يعني
انت اتصلت بي؟
ايوه اتصلت بك لانه كان لي باسبورت فقلت لهم اعرف في اليوم
فيه
عملت اليوم
عملت اليوم
لان هي ايش قالت؟ قالت وحتى ربك اليوم لان نحن المسجلين هي متى خرجت يعني
لا لا الباسبورت الذي خرجت ما غيرته نفسه نفسه
هو فهي قالت يعني اذا سيم باسبورت خلاص يعني
نفسه
قالت اني راح اعمل واذا اي تغيير هو ما يحتاج يعني
جزاك الله خيرا
فقط من هذه الريبورت كارد انا ممكن اتواصل معهم بس هي قالت للي عندها يعني لي لو انت تكون ربما افضل يعني
لا ان شاء الله هم يسمحون بالدخول في المدرسه
عادي عادي انا ادخل
انا ادخل ان شاء الله
سكيورتي دايركت على طول تسجل هناك وفي عندي سكيورتي
جزاك الله خير استاذ جلال بارك الله فيك
هذا الباب ليس لي
السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته I'm very sorry a guest come and I have to attend to him ان شاء الله Okay, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة العالمين نبينا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم Today our class is disturbed from every dimension so I hope you will tolerate that and exercise more patience with this miskin May Allah guide him Al-Mujahid Ibn Jabr I was talking about the system we have in nowadays and which is almost everywhere wherever you go especially the Muslim territories. You know, if you look at the past and you study the siyasa shar'iyya, you will know that any the system we are following is not the best one to be followed. But what to do? We have nothing except to follow and submit. But we can do something. What is that thing we can do, which is to fix ourselves? Everyone should fix himself. I fix myself, you fix yourself, your friend fix himself, you fix your family, you fix everyone. At the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to fix everything for us. And we do what we can do, the rest Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do it for us. Do you get the idea? وَعِدُّ لَهُمَّ سَطَعَةُ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ So we just do whatever we can do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do the rest for us. Do you get the idea? If we can do something, you know, to modify the system, that would be good. But this one might be so long. And the best way for it is to educate yourself and be also part of the system, you know, if it is suitable for you to be part of the system, then change will come. Or else the best method we have is to fix ourselves to be good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. He will let our leaders be guided, you know, by his Sharia. And he will let our leaders become righteous and somebody who shows mercy upon us. You know, Wallahu ala kulli shayin qadir. As-salamu Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tawfiqa wa sada. So Mujahid ibn Jabr. Okay, Mujahid ibn Jabr says, Wallahu la yuhibbu al-fasad. This is a part of a Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Wallahu la yuhibbu al-fasad. Thumma qara'a, and then Mujahid ibn Jabr, he recited the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Zahara al-fasad fi al-barri wal-bahri bima kasabat aydi al-nasi, liyudhiqahum ba'da al-ladhi amilu la'allahum yarji'un. Thumma qala, Ama wallahi, ma huwa bahrukum hadha? ولكن كل قرية على ماء جار فهو بحر And then Mujahid said Well, أما والله ما هو بحركم هذا He said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not talking about the bahr, the sea you know But he is talking about the normal water that is next to the river that is next to everyone. He says, ثم قال أما والله ما هو بحركم هذا ولكن كل قرية على ماء جار فهو بحر. He says, any city, you know, that is next to a river, that river is called also bahar, could be called bahar. So it doesn't mean that the bahar that is what you call far from us. It means the water in general. Water in general. وقال يا كريم ظاهر الفساد في البر والبحر أما إني لا أقول بحركم هذا ولكن كل قرية على ما. Ikrima also said, like Mujahid ibn Jabr. وقال قتادة أما البر فأهل العمود وأما البحر فأهل القرى والريف. He says أما البر فأهل العمود, يعني أهل البوادي. Allah سبحانه وتعالى says في البر والبحر أما البر فأهل العمود. أهل العمود, he's talking about the people of the bawadi, the villages. You know, al-Badia, you know, those kind of old villages where you find a house here and then another one a bit far from it. But they are one community. So he says, fil-barri. The bar is referring to those type of communities. وَأَمَّا الْبَحْرُ فَأَهْلُ الْقُرَىٰ. As for the bahr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to أَهْلُ الْقُرَىٰ وَالْرِيفِ. أَهْلُ الْقُرَىٰ وَالْرِيفِ, these are the cities and also the some type of villages. قلت وقد سمى الله وقد سمى الله تعالى الماء العذب بحرا. Ibn Al Qayyim says there is also a place where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala call الماء العذب, the water that is sweet. You know, you have two types of water. Some scholars said bahar is used to address the salty one, al-ma'u al-milh. But he says there is also a place where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala call the water the water that is salih al-shurb, good for drinking. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala call it baharan. When he says wa ma yastawi al-baharani hadha 'adhbun furatun sa'igun sharabuhu wa hadha milhun ujaj. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says ما يستوي البحراني هذا عذب فرات, سائغ شرابه. The two seas, they will never be equal to each other. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called both of them seas. هذا عذب فرات. عذب فرات means the one that is suitable for drinking. وهذا ملح وجاج. And the milh, the other one that is not suitable for drinking because it is salt. It is salty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called it ملح وجاج. But he called both of them bahar, the one that is suitable for drinking and the one that is not suitable for drinking. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called them both bahar. وَلَيْسَ فِي الْعَالَمِ بَحْرٌ حُلْوٌ وَاقِفًا وَإِنَّمَا هِيَ الْأَنْهَارُ الْجَارِيَةُ. And he says we couldn't find any bahar, on earth, that is sweet and also standing still in one place. He said we don't have this. وَإِنَّمَا هِيَ الْأَنْهَارُ. So that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to the rivers. وَالْبَحْرُ الْمَالِحُ هُوَ السَّاكِنُ. And the bahr that is malih, this is the sakin. Sakin means the one which is standing still. فَسَمَّى الْقُرَى الَّتِي عَلَيْهَا الْمِيَاهُ الْجَارِيَةُ بِاسْمِ تِلْكَ الْمِيَاهُ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he called Al-Qura, the cities, which are next to the water, next to the river, Bismitil Kalmiya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called them using the name of the water itself, Bahar. So, but he's referring to that city. Ibn Al-Qayyim is trying to justify the statement of Qatada ibn Da'ama al-Sadusi. وقال ابن زيد ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر قال الذنوب. Ibn Zayd says the fasad that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to, ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر. Allah is talking about the dhunub, the dhunub, the sins. قلت وأراد أن الذنوب سبب الفساد الذي ظهر. Ibn Qayyim says Ibn Zayd is referring to the sins to be the cause for the dhunub that appears. وإن أراد أن الفساد الذي ظهر هو الذنوب نفسها فيكون اللام في قوله ليذيقهم بعض الذي عملوا لام العاقبة والتعليل. He said, but if he is intending that the fasad الذي ظهرت هو الذنوب, the fasad that appears in the bar and bahar is the ذنوب, you know, نفسها, the ذنوب itself, you know, ذنوب themselves, then the lam in the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا will be the lam of al-aqiba. Lam of al-aqiba. Aqiba means the end, you know, the conclusion. وَالتَّعْلِيلِ, you know, the reason why this happened is because of this. You know, you guys are receiving this because of this. So that shows the differences in terms of approaches by the scholars. What exactly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant by the fasad? Is it the dhunub or the consequence of the dhunub? You know, is it the dhunub themselves or the consequence of the dhunub? وعلى الأول فالمراد بالفساد نقص النقص والشر والآلام التي يحدثها الله في الأرض عند معاصي العباد. If you go with the first interpretation where the scholars, many of them, look at the fasad as the result of the sins, you know, then what is the meaning of the fasad then? When Allah says ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر, what is the meaning of the fasad? The fasad here, ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر, the fasad here is النقص, deficiency, والشر, and the evil, والآلام, and the pain that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يحدثها في الأرض عند معاصي العباد. The one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring to the earth when people go against the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a really strong meaning which we need to pay attention to it, you know. The barakah is gone from the food, from the fruit, from the earth, you know, from almost everything. Why this barakah is taken away from us? Because of our sins. So that's why he says, according to the first approach, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the deficiency that is taking place in the sea and also deficiency on the land. We will talk about this, inshallah. كما قال بعض السلف, كلما أحدثتم فكلما أحدثوا ذنبا أحدث الله لهم عقوبة. You know, whenever a people commit sin, you know, introduce a sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring a new punishment which they might not experience it before. So whenever they commit sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring a new punishment for them. قَالَ كَمَا قَالَ بَعْضُ السَّلَفِ, just like the way some of the Salafus Salih said, كُلَّمَا أَحْدَثْتُمْ ذَنْبًا أَحْدَثَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ مِنْ سُلْطَانِهِ عُقُوبًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will introduce a new punishment for us according to the new sins that we are introducing to the earth. قال ابن القيم رحمه الله, والظاهر والله عالم أن الفساد المراد به الذنوب وموجباتها. Ibn al-Qayyim says, Wallahu alam, you know, al-Zahir, you know, he says, al-Zahir, the most closest opinion to the truth, is the one that says, al-Fasad al-Murad bihi al-Dhunub wa Mujibatuha. Both are intended. The sins and also the causes of the sins or the consequences of the sin. ويدل عليه قوله تعالى ليذيقهم بعض الذي عملوا فهذا حالنا وإنما أذاقنا الشيء اليسير من أعمالنا فلو أذاقنا كل أعمالنا لما ترك على ظهرها من دابة. So Ibn al-Qayyim says, we understand that the best opinion should be the one that said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing both, you know, the consequence and the causes themselves, the causes and the effects. And he says, that's where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْضَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا, so that Allah will let them taste some part of the evil consequence of the evil manners. So Ibn al-Qayyim says, فَهَذَا حَالُنَا, he said, this is our situation, this is our condition. وَإِنَّمَا أَذَاقَنَا الشَّيْءَ الْيَسِيرَ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just letting us to taste some, you know, not all. وَلَوْ أَذَاقَنَا كُلَّ أَعْمَالِنَا, لما ترك على ظهرها من دابة. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to let us taste the evil consequence of all of our sins, nobody will remain on earth. Nothing will remain alive. That's why somebody was right when he says that, yes, on the day of judgment, you will understand why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very angry with people. Living in this life, you will understand why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is angry with people on the day of judgment. قال ومن تأثير المعاصي في الأرض ما يحل بها من الخصف والزلازل ومحق بركتها. سبحان الله. He says one of the evil consequences of the ma'asi and the negative effect that ma'asi is having on the earth itself, ما يحل بها, what falls on earth, what affects earth and falls on it, what is that? He says of the al-khasf. Al-khasf is to sink, to have some part of the earth collapsing, going down. You can call it the slides you have on the earth. Sometimes the mountain will just, some part of the hill will just slide and collapse. And sometimes you just see the road will just open and whatever is next to it will go down. That's the khasf, to have some part of the earth being open and whatever is next to that place will go down. وَالزَّلَازِلْ and the earthquake. وَيَمْحَقُ بَرَكَتَهَا and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove the barakah of the earth. I hope each and every one of us is paying attention to this, because this is exactly the description of who we are. لَقَدْ مَرَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَى دِيَارِ ثَمُودَ فَمَنَعَهُ مِنْ دُخُولِ دِيَارِهِمْ إِلَّا وَهُمْ بَكُونَ. He says the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed through the houses of Thamud. Thamud, we already know, Qawm Salih, we know who they are. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed through their houses. And he told the companions not to enter the places. SubhanAllah, SubhanAllah. He told them not to even go to that place, And nowadays we are making its places of enjoyment and tourism. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them not to go to those places. فَمَنَعَهُمْ مِنْ دُخُولِ دِيَارِهِمْ إِلَّا هُمْ بَاكُونَ except if they are crying. They have to reflect, remember what happened to these people. And from the houses of the Thamud, they're in Saudi Arabia, still there, the balance of the building is still there. You can understand that, yes, you are dealing with, subhanAllah, giant, creatures, They're so big, and they think they're something, They think they are somebody, and nobody can deal with them except in the way they want. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't have capacity and ability to get them. But where are they? They're gone. وَمِنْ شُرْبِ مِيَاهِهِمْ وَمِنَ الْاِسْتِقَاءِ مِنْ أَبَارِهِمْ حَتَّى أَمَرَ أَنْ يُعْلَفَ الْعَجِينُ الَّذِي عُجِّنَ بِمِيَاهِهِمْ لِلنَّوَاضِحِ. So, لِتَأْثِيرِ الشُّؤْمِ الْمَعَاصِي فِي الْمَاءِ وكذلك تأثير شؤم الذنوب في نقص الثمار وترمى به من وما ترمى به من الآفات. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, do not enter the place except if you are crying. And also he told them not to drink from their water. Subhanallah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them not to drink from their water. That this is the place where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down his wrath on them. And also, he told them not to fetch water from the wells they find in that place. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, any flower that is al-ajin, I don't know how to say it in English, but this is the flour that you mix to make khubz, bread or cake and all this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them to throw it away. Throw it away, give it to the camels, but they cannot eat it, Why لِتَأْثِيرِ الشُّؤْمِ الْمَعَاصِي? Because of the ma'asi, Because of the negative effect that the ma'asi has. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خَشِتَ أَنْ يُسِيبُكُمْ مَا أَصَابَهُمْ, the balance of that punishment, how many years? Thousands of years. But the balance of this punishment might be there. So he says, don't come across, don't go to that place and don't enter the place except if you are crying. قَالَ كَذَلِكَ تَأْثِيرُ شُؤْمِ الذُّنُوبِ فِي نَقْصِ الثِّمَارِ وَمَا تُرْمَى بِهِ مِنَ الْآفَاتِ. He said this is also the same way you see the ma'asi of Thamud might remain up to date, you know, might remain up to date. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it might remain up to date. خَشِتَ أَنْ شِيبَكُمْ مَأْصَابُمْ. Ibn Al-Qayyim says the same goes to the ma'asi and the dhunub. This is what they do. They have also great, strong, negative effect, on the earth and things that you find on earth. Somebody might say, but people are visiting, and they don't have, nothing affects them, But don't forget, Wallahu Halim. And nowadays, when people neglect something, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be Halim to hold them accountable of that which they're doing. And it might be a test also, because sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might remove the effect to test a person. It doesn't mean it is not effective. No, it does. It does. Allah will get them in other ways, but this one might be taken away for a while, so that a person will receive a complete punishment on the day of judgment. So don't be deceived by what you have heard. Some people might be saying that all of those, I heard that somebody saying that all of these narrations, we have to stay away from them. They don't believe in them. We are just neglecting opportunities, somebody says. We're just neglecting opportunities. We can just open up the place for the tourism and people can just come and we get a lot. But don't forget what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that these type of things, a person has to be very careful. We got what we got, and we are in the situation where we are in. I'm talking about life before the arrival of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changed it to an excellent and a very good life. Why is that? Because of the tawheed, because of the submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of Islam. By the time we started making our own interpretations and making our own deductions and staying away from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants, we should be ready for a change from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وقد ذكر الإمام أحمد في مسنده في ضمن حديث حديث قال وجد في خزائن بني أمية حنطة الحبة بقدر نواة التمر وهي في صرة مكتوب عليها هذا كان ينبت زمن العدل. Imam Ahmad collected in his Musnad in a hadith. Part of this hadith says that there was a time they found in one of the treasures, the storage of Banu Umayya, they found a piece of they found a grain. They found a grain of hinta, that's the wheat, one grain of wheat. Ala qadri nawat al-tamr, and it is so big, like the seed, like the date seed, and this is only one grain. And it is mentioned, it was written on it, and they found it in fi sarratin, in a small bag. It was kept, by the community there, as a sample, an example for the next generation to see. Maktubin alayha hadha kana yanbutu zaman al-adl. This used to grow during the day of justice. Subhanallah. It used to grow during the days of justice. So, what happened to the grain now? Go and see the wheat, and see how big it is. Go and see the rice and see how it is.
وأخبرني جماعة وكثير من هذه الآفات أحدثها الله بما أحدث العباد من الذنوب.
And he says most of these deficiencies and problems that take place on earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts them on the earth because of the sins of the humankind. Most of this sickness and deficiency and diseases that we are suffering from, I have no doubt, my dear brothers and sisters, it is because of us. So as I always mention, don't you ever say, what can I do? I'm living in just one out of 8 billion, or 9 billion. Allahu A'lam, how many people we have on earth? What can I do? No, you can do a lot. You can do a lot. Just fix yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how to grant you a good life and a pleasant. In the middle of all of these tragedies, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how to extract you, from all of these tragedies and make you living as if you are living alone in an isolated place where shar is not coming to you. Do you remember that man, you know, that we talked about earlier, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent clouds to his farm alone? What happened to the farms next to him, you know? He got it. You can see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is protecting this person in the middle of all of the other farms. Allah is selecting this one alone, you know. Dear brothers and sisters, this is a very good lesson for all of us to understand that wallahi, nothing should work in our life except pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, that's how we should contribute, you know, to fixing the things on earth. Just fix yourself. And also invite others to good. The one next to you. No need to go to the street and invite everyone. No, just start with the one who's next to you. You're a teacher, fix the classroom. You're a parent, and fix your children. Your husband, fix your wife. Your wife, fix your husband. You know, you are a child, respect your parents. If the parents are going in the wrong direction, fix them, you know. So what I meant is everyone should participate in bringing good. How do I bring good? I should fix myself and also try to invite others to fix their attitude and manners. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do it for us, be the lighter.
قال وأخبرني جماعة من شيوخ الصحراء أنهم كانوا يعهدون الثمار أكبر مما هي الآن وكثير من هذه الآفات التي تصيبها لم يكونوا يعرفونها وإنما حدثت من قرب.
Subhanallah. Ibn Al Qayyim says some of the old, you know, people from those who are living in the desert, you know, away from the corruption of the cities and the qura. You know, they are away from the corruption that takes place in the cities and the qura and the riyaf. You know, they are away from that. So he said, I met some of these old people and they told me that the fruit, they used to be bigger than this. You know, he said the fruit used to be bigger than this. He says that most of these deficiencies and problems that take place in our fruit, he said, لَمْ يَكُونُوا يَعْرِفُونَهَا مِنْ قَبْلِ. They did not know about it before. وَإِنَّمَا حَدَثَتْ مِنْ قُرْبٍ. He said, it happens, يعني, مِنْ قُرْبٍ, not very long, a time ago.
وَأَمَّا تَأْثِرُ الذُّنُوبِ فِي الصُّوَرِ وَالْخَلْقِ فَقَدْ وَرَدَ فقد روى الترمذي في جامعه عنه أنه قال أنه صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال خلق الله آدم وطوله في السماء 60 ذراعا فلم يزل الخلق ينقص حتى الآن. Ibn Al-Qayyim says, as for the effect of the ma'asi on the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his sword, the features, you know, the way human beings look like, and also wal khalq, and the creation itself. He says, فَقَدْ رَوَى التِّرْمِذِي فِي جَامِعِهِ عَنْهُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمَ أَنَّهُ قَالَ خَلَقَ اللَّهُ آدَمَ وَطُولُهُ 60 ذِرَاعًا. At-Tirmidhi collected hadith that says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam, وَطُولُهُ 60 ذِرَاعًا. And the size of Adam, the height is 60 dhira, around 30 meters. You know, that's Adam. You remember the hadith of the ru'ya, the one that we just read last week. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "I saw Ibrahim alaihi salam, and he said I was, you know, it's like I cannot see the head of Ibrahim alaihi salam. It was quite tall." So what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept on reducing the size of the creation until the nation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When it reached the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then it was reduced to the one we see nowadays. قَالَ فَإِذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ أَنْ يُظَهِّرَ الْأَرْضَ مِنَ الظَّلَمَةِ وَالْفَجَرَةِ وَالْخَوَنَةِ يُخْرِجُ عَبْدًا مِنْ عِبَادِهِ مِنْ أَهْلِ بَيْتِهِ.
Okay, I guess this is very important part which needs a bit of clarification. I don't think it's good for us to go through it because I will rush. So I will leave the session for question and answers. If not, then I see you insha'Allah ta'ala on Saturday for those of you who are coming for the class. If not, then on Monday bi-idhnillahi tabaraka wa ta'ala. Barakallahu feekum, everyone. So let's move to question and answers. And sorry for the class, it's a bit distorted. And inshallah, it will not happen again. Barakallahu feekum. Yes, Abdurrahman. I mean, Abdurrahman, your sound is like you are in China, you know. Is if is the area outside?
Yeah, the saha, which is outside the haram, as soon as you get out the gate.
Okay. Zaman ذهبت إلى بلد آخر. حتى السؤال ما سمعته.
The question is, Sheikh.
أيوة.
The area outside. The area outside the haram, going to the hotels over there, to the fanatic, is that considered part of the haram where if you pray, we get the same reward as the Prophet ﷺ promised in haram al-Madini?
It depends on the understanding of the person himself and which opinion is he taking. Some scholars said this reward is given to whoever prays in the haram itself, not just the masjid, but the haram itself. You know, haram is much bigger. It's an area which includes, I mean, many places. When you are coming from Jeddah to Makkah, you see on the way to the haram, you see the signboard that says, this is the bidayatul haram. This is the beginning of the haram. So it's a big area which is demarcated by Ibrahim alayhi salam. That area is a sacred area, not just the masjid. So some scholars said Allah says, أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ لَيْلًا مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ الْأَقْصَى. And we all know that the Isra, the journey began from the house of Umhani, because this is where the angels met him. And they took him out of his house from that place, you know. So they said, and Allah called it Masjid al-Haram. Her house is inside the haram, not inside the masjid, but inside the area of the haram. But other scholars said, no. The journey, although the Prophet ﷺ was brought from his house, but it begins from the haram, because they go to the haram first and then move to Bayt al-Maqdis. So Allahu Alam, the safest opinion is the one that says we're just talking about the masjid itself, only the masjid. What constitutes the masjid is a place that is fenced, that has doors and it is closed. You get it? But if a person prays, you know, and if the sufuf are connected to each other, in the haram al-Makki is always broken. So as long as a person is next to the haram, in that saha, which is meant for the masjid alone, inshallah, I hope bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, he will be able to get the reward. But as I said, to be on the safe side, a person should try his best to pray inside the masjid. Inside the masjid.
Sheikh, what about the haram al-Nabawi in the Prophet's mosque?
The same thing. The rehab, but now since that place has a gate, in the Haram al-Nabawi might be different because it has a gate also. The fences also, the rehab also has a gate, and it is closed, I guess. It has a gate, and that place is selected for the prayers, and now they put even the madallat in it. In our time, I witnessed a time where those umbrellas, they are only in the middle of the masjid inside, but now they have them even out of the masjid. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them abundantly. It really helps a lot, you know. So inshallah, I hope outside the masjid, you know, inshallah, a person will get a reward, especially when the sufuf are connected, you know, to each other, if inside the masjid is full. But if inside the masjid is not full, it is wrong actually for a person to pray outside the masjid. Mm.
The workers, for example, the people who work in the hotels or there, which are just by the haram, they pray inside the hotel, but they get the same reward?
No, that's not the masjid, that's Ismuhu Hotel. إِلَّا عَلَى قَوْلِ مَنْ يَرَى أَنَّ الْأَجْرَ يُعْطَى لِمَنْ صَلَّى فِي الْحَرَمِ. Except according to the opinion of somebody who says the reward is given to whoever prays in haram, not just in the masjid, but in the area of Haram, then yes, not even in the hotels next to the Haram, in any place, even in your house, when you pray, you get that reward. But that's very weak opinion. Yes, Abdurrahman.
Isn't there a hadith which says that from a certain area to a certain area?
It's haram.
Is the masjid and then whoever prays in that part of the reward?
No, the best narration is the one that says it's haram. Like in Medina, he says, Al-Madina tu haramun ma bayna thawrin. Ila Ayir. Some scholars said Thawr fi Makkah, there is no Thawr in Medina. So most likely the correction in that narration is Ma Bayna Uhudin ila Ayir. So that is a space the Prophet is talking about Haram in Makkah and Medina. So he tells us where is it Haram in Makkah from this place to another place. This is the Haram. We're not talking about the Masjid, he's talking about the Haram itself.
Question by Sister Mooney. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu wa rahmatullahi.
If the barakah is taken away from fruits, etc., so is it not just about individually to stop sinning, but those around us also need to stop sinning to ensure that the barakah is not taken away?
Yes, everyone should stop, Sister Mooney. But if I cannot stop everyone, I stop it from myself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, the little He granted me, that which the barakah is removed, when it comes to my house, Allah is capable of putting the barakah in it. It is small in size, but it will be enough for me to survive. It will be enough for you to survive. It will be enough for them to survive. You get that? That's the benefit of being busy with yourself. You know, fix yourself first and then extend the blessing to others. You know, if they listen, alhamdulillah. If they don't listen after you give them the da'wah, Allah says, لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ مَنْ ظَلَّ إِذَا هَتَدَيْتُمْ. The evil attitude will never harm you because you will be under the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Her second question is, my children also ask, how do the sins impact the lives of Hubara? How do you explain?
Al-Hubara or Al-Khudara? Yeah, this is Al-Hadara. Yeah, this one, inshallah, Sister Murni. Are you Abdurrahman?
لَنَا تَقُلْ حُبَارَ بِالْحَاقِ.
Okay. كأنها تقول حضارة. Okay. Let them fix it. But inshallah, in the next class, بإذن الله تعالى, we will be talking about this because Ibn Qayyim went in a bit more detail to talk about this matter. بإذن الله تعالى, as Samuni, let your kids attend the class next Monday, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and your children and put barakah in all of you.
Question by Yan. Sheikh, is it permissible to extract parts of a long dua that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaches to make dua with according to our situation and our need?
Is it possible?
Is it permissible to take part of the dua that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made? Just take a part of it to recite it according to our need and our situation.
Yeah, as long as it is from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's okay. It's okay even to make your own dua. It's okay to take some part of the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You are in a state of fear of something. Allahumma astir awrati wa amin rawati. Allahumma astir awrati wa amin rawati. The dua is not only this, but you just extracted this part and say it a lot, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you your need. That would be okay, inshallah. That's very excellent dua. Allahumma inni as'aluka al-afwa wal-afiyata fi dunya wal-akhirah. Allahumma inni as'aluka al-afwa wal-afiyata fi dini wa dunya wa mahya fi dini wa dunya. Okay, I got stuck. And then the last part of it, he says, Allahumma astur awrati wa amin ru'ati. So you can take some part of it and then mention it in your dua. It's okay, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala.
Question by Sister Noor. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Shaykh. When we make dua, should we always use Al with the beautiful names of Allah, or does it depend if we say in Arabic and with Ya, like we say Ya Hayyu, Ya Qayyum, bi rahmatika astaghith? So do we have to say Ya Al Hayy, Ya Qayyum,
mathala? La yahtaj. Ya Rahman, Ar Rahman, Irhamni. You know, you're calling Allah. Ya Allah, irhamni. It's okay. Anta ar-Rahman, Ya Allah, farhamni. Anta ar-Razzaq, Ya Allah, farzuqni. It's okay, inshallah. The point is to say the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala correctly. That's it. Or the sifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala correctly. It's good to use Ya, because it shows respect. Even if you use the name Mujarrad, it's okay. The respect is in the heart, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. But using Ya, it has the sense of calling and invoking somebody. That's why the scholar said, when you say Ya, if you're going to look for something, if you don't mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you're looking for something which only Allah does, if you don't mention the name of Allah, this is shirk. I heard that some of those people who chose to change their path, you know, from good to deviation. I call it deviation. It says invoking the awliya, you know, is not shirk. Allah guide them. Talk about
the best time to pray. You talked about the time of the Subh prayer.
Uh-huh.
I think it's referring to the Salat al-Fajr. May I know the best time to pray for the residents of Sirdam?
Well, I just checked the taqweem, that prayer time given by the authority. I think this time around the time is a bit good, you know, because there was a time also we are asked to add 8 minutes. You know, that shows concern. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them. Before it wasn't, you know, there was a mistake, you know. That's why you pray Fajr and you still see yourself in a state of darkness, you know, living in the darkness of the night, you know. So Fajr is the beginning of the daylight. But nowadays, alhamdulillah, when we pray Fajr, we come out. Although, by the time we come out, you can see the daylight started to come, you know. A bit, you can see the sky started to open and the night is going. That means we are praying, inshallah, perfectly. So my advice is, don't pray as soon as the adhan has been made. Add at least 10 to 15 minutes. 10 to 15 minutes, if not, add 20. That's the best way to make it, inshallah.
Sheikh, how do we avoid the lead or blind following or getting influenced by a HSP mindset?
Okay, Sanur, barakallahu feekum. I owe you answer to one question, inshallah, after this class also I will answer it for you, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. And how do we avoid taqleed? You know, the best... Right, Abdurrahman, did I get the question properly? How do we avoid taqleed, right? Abdurrahman. Okay, then. So, how do we avoid taqleed? It's very simple. Very simple. To recognize that we are Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to us, not anybody else. This is very important. Allah did not send Malik, Allah did not send Abu Bakr. Forget about Imam Malik, rahimahullah. Allah did not send Abu Bakr to us, radiallahu anhu. Allah did not send Umar. All of those great companions, we respect them, but Allah did not send them to us. Allah sent Rasulullah to us. So you should know that the source of information is only one, which is the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I made them one because they're one. You know, they go with each other. They never get separated. And they will never be separated. You know, you cannot follow Quran and leave the Sunnah. You cannot follow the Sunnah and leave the Quran. So we should know that we are supposed to be following the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And as such, whatever is given to us, it has to be justified. And things must have the evidence, you know. Whatever you're doing, you must have evidence for doing that. قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. You know, so you refer to the scholars. You refer to the scholars. Abdurrahman. Okay, shukran. So, so you have to understand this fact correctly, that we are supposed to be following Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The scholars, they were there to guide us, you know, on how to maintain this allegiance, you know, to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, Noor, this is what we should be doing. And whatever somebody tells you, you should look for the evidence for that. You know, and this evidence could be Hadith and the Quran, and these are the root, you know, and any other evidence is going to base on them, qiyas, you know, or some other evidence which are agreed upon by the scholars, ijma, you know, and on. But the root and the most important thing you should be looking for is the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So taqleed is bimanzilat akhlil mayta. Taqleed, blind following, is just like the eating a dead animal for somebody who is in a state of necessity, or else you should be receiving the evidence and the justification for whatever you are doing. That's why it is necessary for you to choose somebody who you trust, you know, who you know that this person is according to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he goes with the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This one will not misguide you, and he will try to tell you whatever he says. Even sometimes they might not attribute it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but you know that this person, in almost everything he says, he will try to tell you the dalil for that. Why are we supposed to do that? Do you get the idea? So you don't need to ask every scholar whenever they talk to you. You have to tell them, okay, what is the dalil? And in the way we see people are disrespecting the scholars, no. You get the best one, somebody who is upon the Sunnah and the correct manhaj of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and receive from those ones. And usually you find those ones, whenever they talk to you, they justify and they substantiate that which they are saying, and they link it to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what is the best way to avoid taqleed? Understand the real nature of the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you are supposed to link yourself to Rasulullah, not to anybody else. You're supposed to connect yourself to Rasulullah, not to anybody else. You know, whatever he says, you do it. Whatever he asks you to stay away from it, stay away from it. No modification, no ta'wil, all of this modern interpretation, keep them aside if you want to succeed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us good and success in life. Abdurrahman, your mic went back to the old life. Some Muslim who make what? They make takbir and...
So how do we know if what they were saying? Takbir and tabdir. So how do we know if they're...
Takbir and tabdir.
Yeah.
Wallahi, my advice to you, Noor, and everyone, you shouldn't get busy with this. Learn the Quran, learn the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This word, takfir, is very dangerous, very dangerous. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when you do it, it will be checked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and will never fall down.
it will go to somebody who deserves it. If the person you level the takfir on deserves it, it will be on him. If he doesn't deserve it, it will come back to you. So it's a very sensitive matter and very dangerous. And calling a person mubtada, he has to qualify that. You know, if a person qualifies the kufr, yes, you call him kafir wala karama. If that person is kafir, you call him kafir wala karama. We don't care. He's kafir, kafir. You know, no respect at all. Kafir, kafir. Yeah, we have good manners. We do it with everyone, kafir and non, and Muslims and everyone. Yes, we did receive good manners from us, but the title given to them by Allah, we keep it in the way it is. Kafir is kafir. You call him kafir. But be very careful when you level the words on your Muslim brothers and sisters, and they don't deserve it. That would be very dangerous. That would be very dangerous. The same goes to tabdi'ah. You don't call a person mubtadi' unless if he's really doing the bid'ah. If he's doing the bid'ah, yes, you call him mubtadi' wala karama. And he's mubtadi'. But for you, Noor, and everyone who's looking for the truth, I guess I'm dealing with Christina, if I'm not mistaken. Anyone who's looking for the truth, I really choose for you not to get busy with these things. Study, keep studying, keep studying. Select the best amongst the scholars and take your knowledge from them. What do I mean by the best? Mean scholars of the Sunnah and the Quran, those people who are not following their desires. You know, go and study from them. Keep studying, keep studying. Educate yourself. Don't get busy with this jarh wa ta'dil, fulan, 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 fulan. My experience throughout my life, all of those people who get themselves busy with this jarh wa ta'dil, you know, this criticism, criticizing this sheikh is this sheikh. Wallahi, I have never come across any one of them who is, educated, who reached the level of the scholarship. This is my experience. I have never come across one of them who become somebody in terms of knowledge. Why? Because you cannot just keep accusing people. And sometimes they accuse people who they are. You know, righteous scholars, you know. Righteous scholars who we don't know anything. But you see those, somebody who doesn't even know how to fix his prayer, but he will tell you that this sheikh is batil, this sheikh is batil. And they're big shiukh, you know. We met scholars in Medina, subhanAllah. Very great scholars in the Islamic University of Medina. In terms of taqwa, you might say that your eyes never saw somebody like them, you know. حَسَبُهُمْ كَذَلِكَ وَاللَّهُ حَسِيبُهُمْ. In terms of manhaj, in terms of following the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you might be thinking that this is the best person you will ever see in your life. But you see somebody who is there criticizing, cursing, and if you ask him, why do you talk against him? They will tell you that, because he talks too much about the raka'ik, those things that are softening the heart, you know. You know, I'm just sharing experiences, you know. But Imam al-Dhahabi says, there was a scholar who was rejected by some students, you know. And the reason why they rejected him is because he prays a lot of sunnah prayers. SubhanAllah. Imam al-Dhahabi says, he says, SubhanAllah, وَهَلْ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا الْعَمَلُ بِهِ. Is there any value to the knowledge if you don't put it into practice and action? But SubhanAllah, Allah, he was right. I met those kind of people. You can say the least in terms of ibadat. The least in terms of ibadat. If you go to the Masjid Prophet, they call you Sufi. You know, you rush to the Masjid of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they will call you Sufi. And you have all the names. Why? Because you are going, you know, to get those virtues with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam advises to get. They deprive people from the right path and from the right way. Many of them regret it afterwards. So, Christina and everyone, I really advise you to be busy with the knowledge. Please, get busy with the knowledge. Study, study, study from the right sources. And select the best amongst the scholars to study from them. Who are the best? Those people that you have good expectation that these ones will not cheat you in the fatwa, and they have the knowledge to guide you. Keep studying. You will become, inshallah, like them or even better than them. Then you don't need somebody to come and dictate to you how to behave. May Allah grant us good. Abdurrahman, I have only 4 minutes to run away. How many questions left?
Sheikh, there is
okay, just keep asking, inshallah. When the time comes, I will just say assalamu alaikum.
Four questions left.
Okay.
I remember Sheikh saying we should add 10 to 15 minutes to Fajr time.
Yes.
I thought this was general for everyone.
Yeah, this is good.
Those are based on the advice of the authority.
This is good to add 10 to 15 minutes because you know the controversy of the scholars in Saudi Arabia, in Egypt, in many other places, you know. And this is applicable to everyone because we are using the same calendar. So they detect, and some scholars said they detect that the designers of the calendars, they base sometimes the prayer time on the first Fajr, which is the wrong one. So that's why Ibn Uthaymeen used to advise, he says at least 5 minutes. Some scholars said at least 20 because they found in some countries the difference between the real time and the wrong one is 25 minutes, you know, in some places. Sheikh Nasser said, he said in Amman, you know, in Jordan, in the place where he lived, he said, Alhamdulillah, you know, Allah bless him to live at the edge of the city. He said, I see his Fajr and I see sunrise and I see sunset and I see his Fajr. Very clearly, because I'm away from the electricity and the problems in the city. And then he said, I couldn't see a single masjid that is praying Fajr on it real time in the whole place where he is living, except one masjid. He said every time he has to travel, the masjid is a bit distant from him, he has to travel every day for Fajr prayer to go and reach that masjid. You know, subhanAllah. So that's why, Alhamdulillah, here in Malaysia and almost everywhere, I guess, nobody's praying right on time. The only problem is with the sisters at home. You know, I advise you for Fajr, delay it a bit. You know, after the Fajr time, the one that is announced, get at least 10 to 15 minutes. You know, I would prefer 15 minutes and above. You know, that's better for you to be on the safe side, inshallah. Even the Sunnah al-Fajr, pray it at that moment, because those Sunnah of the Fajr are supposed to be prayed after the arrival of the Fajr.
Naam, Sheikh. The next question is by Sister Murni. Okay, it's similar to the one before.
Okay.
The next question is by Brother Saeed. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. Does the deceased body feel pain, or does the hadith of bones breaking refer to the dignity of the body?
Yeah, this is the dignity of the body. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kulli shay'in qadir. If the person asks people to do it, Allah might make him feel it. But this is referring to the respect of respect to the Muslim. Kasru azmi al-mayitika kasrihi hayya. If you go to the Zahiris, Khalid is here. If you go to the Zahiris, they will tell you that if a person breaks the bone of a dead person, you know, a qisas has to be taken. Majority of the scholars said no qisas between the dead person and the living one, because there is no compatibility. This one is dead and the other one is alive. This one doesn't feel it and the other one feels it. So they said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is referring to respect, you know. But it is strictly prohibited for a person to break the bone of a dead person. Okay, Abdurrahman, I guess the rest of the questions, they have to forgive me until the next class. Is that okay?
Sheikh, in fact, we are done with the questions, Alhamdulillah.
Oh, Alhamdulillah. You see some mu'jiza, right? Some karamat? Okay, I'm just kidding. Abdurrahman, stop saying this. You know, I think people have to help me with Abdurrahman. Abdurrahman always disturbed me, tell me he went to Medina, he went to Makkah. So I was there at home, you know, thinking of how to come and join him, you know, subhanAllah. That life, I cannot forget it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put barakah in you. And shows the day, inshallah. I have a proposal. Inshallah, when the coronavirus is gone, We have people from Singapore. This is a proposal, and Sheikh Ashraf and the people from Malaysia and everywhere. Inshallah, one day when the coronavirus is gone, let us have a trip. You know, people from Singapore, people from wherever. We have a trip. We meet all together in Saudi Arabia. We have a Umrah there. Inshallah, an educational trip. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. We visit places and talk about the history in that place. Inshallah. We did it once with the student of Nottingham and Inti College. And it was so excellent, one of my best Umar that I did in my life. You know, because we go to every place and we sit in every place with no hesitation, and we talk about the history in the same place wherever the things happened. So I guess, inshallah, put this in mind one day, inshallah. Let us just have this plan and to see how to make it possible. We go with our families. It will be really excellent, inshallah ta'ala. And then we meet Abdurrahman in his house, inshallah.
Okay.
Barakallahu feekum, Abdurrahman. Jazakumullah khairan. Okay. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.